All right, welcome ladies and gentlemen here at our fireside chat. My name is Ramon Vullings and I'm very honored to be here at Timon's place, Timon de Jong. I've invited Timon to join in this beautiful chat to talk about future human behavior. Timon, can you explain to people a little bit about yourself?
Yes. Well, first of all, Ramon, thank you for inviting me for this chat. Yeah, my name is Timon de Jong. We're here in my studio in Amsterdam, the virtual studio, saying hello here. This is our setup. And I'm a social psychologist specialized in the future of human behavior. So the world is changing, human behavior is changing, and what are the implications for business strategy and leadership? And I do keynotes, leadership training, workshops around the globe for all kinds of organizations.
Wonderful.
Oh yeah, and I lecture at the social psychology department of Utrecht University. So one foot in the academic world as well.
Great. And if you've been to ISPIM before, you may have seen me passing by. My name is Ramon Vullings. I'm Dutch, living in Antwerp, Belgium. And I'm a keynote speaker on mixing ideas cross sectors, cross industries. And I'm an idea DJ, at least. I'm trying to get more business leaders to become better idea DJs, mixing ideas cross domains and also in terms of behavior. And that's what we're going to talk about today.
I actually put your... Ramon didn't put his book there. His new book is right there. I said, Ramon, put your book up. It's so big that it actually stands up. Ooh, like a real book. So... Oh, now it's moved. I'm writing my first book, so...
You've already signed the contract, I believe.
I have a contract with a publisher in the United States, but this is your second book already, so I'm a bit jealous.
It's actually the fourth, but it's okay.
It's the second one you've given me.
Yeah,
all right,
true.
So you owe me two
absolutely
books.
True, absolutely
Ramon
true.
Owes me two books. Yeah. I have two of them here in the bookshelf. All right.
Yeah, great. Indeed, it's just out. Great leaders mix and match. So that's... What we're also going to talk about today is how business leaders are trying to make the best of this mix that we're in, because we're now slowly stepping out of a pandemic.
Light at the end of the tunnel.
Yeah, but you have a different process to that. You don't think we're going from this situation to the next, from A to B, but there's actually a process between these things.
Yeah, so it's actually a fallacy, a thinking error to think, all right, we're still in the crisis right now, and then it's post-pandemic world. So it's a two-phase model. It's actually, if we look at human behavior, it's a three-phase model. Can I draw something along
yes,
here?
You can.
Because I have a sheet here. Here we are. So it's a three-phase model. We have the crisis. And yes, in the third phase, we go post-pandemic. Let's call it post-COVID. But there is a second phase in between, which is called the transformation or sometimes compensation phase. And the interesting thing is, this phase, around 12 months, this is the first phase that we'll enter. And the true post-COVID world that we hear so much about is actually more than a year away from us. Shall I run through
yeah,
this?
Yeah, go. I'm really interested in your model.
Yeah, so the model here. So if we look at how behavior will change right here, we have to take a look at how behavior has changed during the crisis. So what we've seen is that people have gotten more religious in the crisis, or there has been more conspiracy thinking in the crisis. We've seen less spending and less risk-taking. And this is where it gets relevant. Risk-taking for Ramon. So we've seen both consumers and larger multinationals, so our clients, spend less. And the interesting thing is that in a crisis situation, people say, well, you need to spend, you need to take a risk, because a crisis is an opportunity. And there are often wonderful examples of startups that were founded in crisis situations. And then they give examples of Airbnb and Pinterest being founded in the previous financial crisis. But those are all, how should we call them, Ramon?
Low-risk virtual digital businesses, and then using especially a peer-to-peer kind of asset-based model, both on Pinterest, who has a beautiful database of links, and of course Airbnb, which is absolutely a brilliant idea in itself, yet also from a business perspective, not so much risk in itself.
No, mostly started out from a student dorm room or a you know, parents' garage. But if we look at, you know, larger organizations, and that's most likely your organization, they see that they actually take less risk in a crisis situation and spend less. And last but not least, we see that people, especially now the crisis is taking so long, get less social. So the quantity and the quality of the contacts they have, business and private, decrease, and mental health is also decreasing. Now, the great thing about this phase here is that we're going to see a 180 degree turn of all these trends right here. So people get less religious and there's less conspiracy thinking, which I think, ooh, is great news. Now, here for innovation, and this is very important, we're going to see loads of spending and loads of risk taking. So what I hear from many of my, for example, B2B clients, is that they say we have a hard time selling our innovative products and services. We have something new, we have something disruptive, but we can't sell it because our clients are saying, no, I'm not taking a risk in this crisis, or I don't have the mental health, the mental energy to, you know, because it take, it, no, that's a question for you. How much energy and mental health do people need to actually be, you know, great innovators, great leaders, and actually be IDJs?
It's a clear leadership task also to clear out agendas. In many organizations, what we see is that the best people who have a tendency to deliver get asked or tasked to run this next innovation project. Mm. And that's a classical situation, a classical fallacy there as well, is that these best performers get the new projects. And at the end, they actually burn out because many key innovators also tend to be pleasers because they work a lot, they work too much in many cases, and they try to deliver, they really put themselves wholeheartedly in there. And it's a key leadership trait to actually protect these people from themselves, mm-hmm. and to also take some responsibilities away, delegate them away, transfer them over, to really allow time and space and money in this case to innovate. And that's an interesting thing that we'll see, is that key organizations and key leaders will then allow their people to really have time and space and money in this case to innovate. So that's an interesting play to see that some of my larger clients have a deliberate strategy on freeing up their key people to allow them to innovate.
And is there a magic number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 days a week for that, or?
The magic number is always 42, but in this case, no. There are clients of mine who have dedicated people who are full-time available for innovation, which works. And we have people who still have a nice balance with, as they say, the business, whatever the difference is there, that do that 50-50. And it is indeed a case that if you only do it, let's say, one day a week, that's a situation that gets pressurized. And that's, in many cases, not such a success formula. But somewhere between 50% and 100% is absolutely beneficial in many cases.
Excellent. Let me do these last lines here. Because this is actually, I think, the best news. I'm a social psychologist. That people... You'll hear about this social explosion, that people get extremely social and our mental health will improve. If we get more social, mental health will improve. And this is an interesting one. The social one is that now we have COVID as a driver for this, a virtual conference or this. I don't know if you can see the picture in the background. This is like your average team or Zoom meeting. If this will disappear, we'll get more social. We start to spend, we start to take more risks. I think it's an ideal environment for innovation.
Yeah. I work a lot with high-tech startups in Germany, especially. High-tech Gründerfonds is a large client of mine. We do these yearly sessions where we bring a lot of startups from the German, especially German high-tech ecosystem. So that's biotech, nanotech, and all kinds of other high-tech instances together with German, but also a global set of VCs. These are major events of about 2,500 people running around there. And it's interesting to see that also, of course, last year they went virtual. We had a really nice virtual event. We had over, I believe, 8,000 of these little meetings that the venture capitalists could meet startups to see their solutions, organic 3D printing to being able to replicate skin, you name it. It's all there. Yet, the deal flow actually got less. Why? Mm. Because people, especially VCs, they don't just invest in a technology. they normally invest in a pair of people. So you have the engineer and you have the business person. Normally they're looking for that balance. Eh? You need someone who really knows about the solution and someone who knows how to sell it. And they actually more invest in the people than in the actual solution as it is today, because this might morph to a new environment. So the deal flow actually got less, and they have now deliberately are focusing on getting more face-to-face meetings to get these deals done, because people need to trust people to invest in them to whatever comes next, also as this technology progresses or they change focus. So that's an interesting play that we see also there. We see a pent up of spending for venture capital.
All right, yeah, it's... Well, the academic research is there because this whole situation is one global experiment in how do we respond to forced working from home, forced remote work. And what we've seen around the globe is that if you're too much in this situation or too much in this virtual, is that productivity decreases, creativity decreases, and that's of course vital for innovation, and mental health decreases. And the main reason why these three decrease is the lack of engagement. So yes, there is the quantity, because many of us have loads of these meetings a day. So you have a lot of quantity, so you might see and hear your colleagues, clients, stakeholders, whoever. But the engagement people feel is less, and therefore, you know, there's less trust, there is less feeling, you know, I really know these people. Yeah. And then if you need to sign a deal, so for salespeople, this is a tough time.
Yeah, true. Yeah. I do see some light at the end of the tunnel in terms of supporting technologies. Huh? I guess most of you have now played with a Miro board or a Mural or even Google Docs. And that's a really nice collaborative way of, let's say, in the fuzzy front end to generate ideas and to build upon each other's ideas. Huh? So I see this extra layer of technology-supported ideation. I clearly see that as a clear win. So that's an addition, but you need that human aspect to really bring innovation and ideation to the next level.
Now, I'm still surprised that many of the clients I work with, that the leaders or the sales team still don't have what we have here, a camera, external camera, external microphone, one or two lamps, just a few basics, and that they still sit in the dark with bad audio, bad lights, and are not looking into the camera. If you don't look into the camera, if you can't use your body language, it's very hard to engage. So I thought, you know, give it a few months and then everyone will have a little basic setup, but I'm quite disappointed in the, let's say, working from home office innovation from the larger.
And even positioning your table in terms of the window behind the camera, that's the super tip. Also, if you just use your laptop, make sure that you face a window so the light actually hits your face.
All right. So the interesting question is, of course, how much of this, the virtual this, are we going to keep if COVID as a driver is gone?
Yeah, interesting. And in line with that, it's also that many people are now have high expectations of hybrid events.
The buzzword.
But believe me, if you're going to go for a hybrid event, you're organizing two events, one physical and one virtual. Because in all other circumstances, people have the illusion that you can do a physical event with a little camera and a little digital play, but it makes no sense because your attention is or here or there with the audience at home. So believe me, hybrid is two events. And in terms of, what are we going to keep from this? I think the beauty is that now everybody at least has some experience with cameras, with sharing content also virtually. Apple just is updating their software in their consumer line of products with FaceTime, that you can also share content. So that's interesting things that we'll definitely see. So these weekly, management updates, Monday morning management team meetings and everything. I hope that we are wise enough to be able to mix in the digital version as well. It also democratizes because people have way easier time to join these sessions instead of traveling there, especially internationally. So that's what I really expect to see more. And if we're still going to see these mega manifestations, you have these major conferences, so with 10, 15,000 people. Initially, there will be a key driver there. I believe that's also in your model, that we really want to see each other again.
Yeah.
And after that, let's see how that stabilizes out. I'm still curious.
Yeah, because if you have had, let's say, your client, you have an annual day where you invite all your clients and you've had two of those virtually, then next year when everything is open again and we can travel and we can meet and hug and touch, that you're going to organize a physical event and make it the best event in years because you haven't seen each other in 1.5, 2 years time. So that is going back to this drawing, a social explosion. And then the question is, post-COVID, then we come to phase three, so that's 2023 and onwards, we're going to look back and think, all right, so we've had this, the whole crisis lockdown situation. We've had that social explosion, the best conference ever with the best coffee and the best food because we have to compensate and indulge a little bit. So there will be a moment of reflection. And that's an interesting one here, reflection. Here, only here we'll have the peace of mind to actually, let me move this here. The peace of mind to actually look back, what happened here, and what are we going to keep?
All right.
So many organizations ask me for a specific number. They say, so how much working from home, remote working should we have in our strategy right now? 10%, 20%, 50%, or even more, because then we can close offices and prepare and give people working from home environments even, even better ones. But it's hard to say because we tend, in a crisis situation, overestimate the effect the crisis will have.
Mm-hmm.
And the interesting thing, many of my clients ask their employees what they want. So very democratic, asking the employees now, so how much working from home would you like to do when all of this is over? The problem is that people are here in what's called social withdrawal mode. So we are still here. And people are actually a bit anxious to go back to the office. So a bit of social anxiety, think, all right, how will that be when I go back to the office? Do I really want that? So what we see now in research that many people say, oh, I like this working from home. And the interesting thing is that's not true. it's not good for their mental health. It's not good for their productivity. It's not good for the creativity and therefore not good for the organization. So my advice to leaders in HR department is don't ask people right now. Say, all right, the office is going to open up again. So please come back. And then after a few months of being at the office, doing still some working from home, only then, so in this phase, right here we are again, ask them here in this phase. When we're in this phase, so don't ask them here because you get a wrong answer. People don't know what's good for them. So have them come back for the office, wait a few weeks, a few months, ask them then, and then you get the real answer, what they really want. And then still as a leader, you can decide if you're gonna give them what they want or you say, no, I want everyone at the office or, we're gonna cut loads of costs and we're gonna close. I have a client that is closing 80% of their office space.
Yeah.
So they only have 20% of office space left when all of this is over.
Yeah. Organization run by finance?
The IT firm.
Okay.
So, probably run by finance.
Yeah.
Most likely a CFO turned CEO.
Yeah, something like that.
Yes.
Yeah, because there are clearly benefits to that. Do you see any push? Because in the situation you just described, do you see any initial push to get everybody back into the office? Or do you see a more general tendency in business to allow people to choose more?
I think many organizations allow people to choose.
Yeah.
It depends very much on the leadership. So Microsoft, a client of mine, they say, we're going to leave it open to the people. So if you want to come to the office, you can. If you don't, you can stay at home. And of course, they have many programmers, many IT people who say, let me please work with my computer at home, concentrate, program. Yeah. But there are other organizations. Goldman Sachs, not a client of mine. The CEO said in an interview, I think 2 or 3 months ago, the CEO of Goldman Sachs said, when this is over, I want everyone in the office as fast as possible because working from home is an aberration, which is it's just a mistake. I want everyone at the office. So forcing people back into the office. And there are more, in the media, there are more organizations that say everyone back at the office. My advice would say, encourage everyone to come back in the office, maybe not 5 days a week, but a few days to at least see and meet everyone. And then again, wait a few weeks and a few months where you mix working from home and then have a moment of reflection, have a good conversation and see what works best for individuals, but also teams.
Yeah. And if we talk about innovating our common future, if we see, what do you see the long-term effects and the benefits of this whole period for a longer, sustainable future?
What I can say about this third phase, so there will be a moment of reflection, here you can read it. What we also see in a third phase is that all the problems that we used to have
We used to have the problems. We forgot the problems.
So you know, let's I often use ESG, environment, social, governance. ESG will come back as a boomerang here post-COVID. So the environment, it's never been away, of course, and the social, so income inequality, you know, what do you do for the social environment you operate in as an organization? They'll come back, diversity is in there, inclusion, everything is in there. It's coming back as a boomerang. So now it's all, if you want to focus on, let's say, diversity and inclusion, everyone will say, yeah, it's very important, but please fix this pandemic first. If the government says we need to do something with food waste, people say, food waste? Now, no, vaccination passports, that is, you know, we need to be able to travel and meet each other again. So when we get that out of the way, all the old problems will return. So it's good for leaders to prepare now. And as it will be a time of reflection, there will be mental health will improve. There will be the people will be more open to collaborate. That's the last thing I can say about this post-COVID world. When we reflect, we're open, we open the windows again, and we're open to reflect and collaborate with other organizations, stakeholders. And I think that's for innovation. I think that is a great, great, you know, let's say, a fruitful, fertile ground for innovation.
So moving from urgent to important again?
So it's top of the agenda again. And now COVID is on the agenda, the economic recovery, how do we get every, you know, all the sectors that were hurt by the pandemic, how do we get everyone back with the economy rolling? And here in this part of the world, we're doing just fine. If we look at unemployment rate, the economy, but still, this is now on the agenda. Fix that, done that in 2 years' time, and then it's on to the next thing.
Yeah, I totally agree. For me, what I'm trying to do is to get leaders to think more as idea DJs. What is an idea DJ? It's someone who makes beautiful combinations which are impactful, valuable, and also really have a sustainable long-term impact. And with beauty, I don't just mean, let's say, aesthetic beauty, which is nice, like Apple products, they have an aesthetic beauty to them. But it's more about the way you use them. So it's more about an operational elegance instead of operational excellence. An operational elegance, I mean that it's that data gets entered only one time into a system. Hey, who doesn't have the experience that you need to sign up for a new service or something, and you need to re-enter all your data while you're actually, you've been a client for a long time, or these kind of things. So there are so many ways that organizations can still improve, and especially in the digital era, in terms of getting more elegance into their systems. So that's an interesting play to see there. And I guess now a lot of also my larger clients have clearly made a jump into their digital transformation. I believe you also referenced to that beautiful little thing that's been flying around on the internet and on LinkedIn, who's the main driver of digital transformation in your company, the CIO, the CDO, the CFO, the CEO.
COVID.
Yeah. So these are major drivers that we see, and it does, again, democratizes the system, which is good, because for innovation and collaboration, that that basic layer of digital layer will actually help in terms of collaboration.
That's true. Although I can nuance there a little bit, because I work with the legal team of one of my clients, a big multinational telco. And the legal team said we were working with AI, doing legal research for us before COVID. Mm-hmm. And we were, you know, trying to implement that digital transformation of our, you know, legal department. Then COVID came and all energy went into working from home. How do we connect it? So these are also the lobbyists. So how, mm-hmm. how do you lobby with regulators when you have to do that virtually? So the leader of this team said our digital transformation when it came to AI just stopped because everyone was just busy with this. And they said, we have no time, we have no energy, and I first have to figure this out. And he says, when all of this is over, we can finally go back and start up the AI part of the digital transformation again. So he was very much looking forward to picking up the digital transformation, which was put on hold. So
with an underpinned, I would say, digital collaboration support now. I guess they're now using more these kind of systems, sharing their screens and data and other systems in terms of supporting that. I can totally see that their initial effort or their core effort is less, but I think in terms of collaborating from a distance and digitally, and also linking in maybe people from other countries with other expertises may actually increase.
And have you already seen this with, or have you also seen this with your clients that, you know, because of COVID, so much attention went there, that attention was moved away from wonderful innovation processes they were in?
Incredible. A lot of companies have actually put on hold, stopped, and also they also see the market in terms of testing and trying. I guess some of my clients are also market research companies, and they really had a tough time because a lot of their clients thought, yeah, this market is so different, so you cannot really compare consumer behavior also in business to business. Well, actually now is a perfect time because people actually have time to answer surveys, to do one-on-one questionnaires. People are more used to cameras, so in terms of observing customer behavior, that's also a nice one. So it's interesting to see that a lot of the actual researchers said, no, this is a wonderful time to do research, because now we really get way more time and insights also via cameras in terms of people who, of course, allow, you have the whole, I didn't know, but there's a whole bunch of people allowing all kinds of cameras in their houses for social researchers to see how these lives work. So it's an interesting play to see that. On the one hand, of course, we have a pent-up spending, because we will see a lot of spending coming up. But on the other hand, people also have time now to do different things.
Yeah. But then, you know, if everything starts up again, where will the time go? But that's... I don't know.
That's a nice philosophical question. Where will time go? Is time real? Anyway.
Yeah, that's a good one. And let me see what we also discussed before the recording started. I'm trying to go thinking back because you said something about... no, I lost it.
Fine.
Yes. What else do we have?
Innovating our common future. It's time to slowly wrap our discussion.
Well, let me ask another question. So what are you looking forward to the most when we all come out of, you know, the pandemic, society's opening up again? What's the thing you look forward to?
Yeah, for me, it's dinners with friends.
Dinners with friends?
First and foremost.
All right. And business-wise?
Oh, business-wise. I expect an incredible balance between me flying out. I believe the craziest thing I've ever did a few years ago is fly out to Hong Kong for 10 minutes. So it's like a TED talk for a client there, all the way, the whole process to do that. And I'm actually wondering to see if we will still see these things coming back. In digital times, what I've noticed is that all these keynotes have been compressed. I need to deliver the same kind of content or energy or highlights, but then in, what is it, 25 minutes or something? So all these schedules have been pressurized. And it's also nice to finally, again, do something with clients. I normally have people in an audience, for sure, stand up, talk to the person behind them. Hey, never ask people to talk to the person next to them, because you already know the person sitting next to you. The most interesting networking opportunity, of course, behind you or in front of you if you're sitting in a main room. So these kind of things, I'm really looking forward to introduce this kind of interaction again. And I'm really, I'm actually convinced that we'll see way more requests still for virtual keynotes, if we talk about keynote fields.
Yeah, that's true. I hope so. Because we you have a studio as well.
Yeah.
So it would be a pity if we don't use it anymore.
Yeah. And with this, I'd like to thank you, Timon, for your time, for making your beautiful studio here in Amsterdam available.
Thanks for inviting me.
Yeah, and we wish you an incredible good conference. Thanks a lot.
Bye.
Let's switch to the Hero camera so we have one last view that people can see where we were. Good luck. Thanks.